Welcome, everybody, to a new conversation. Today, we're going to talk about a strange subject, something that is very dear to everybody. We're going to talk about the nobody. We're going to try to figure out who the nobody is. I think the nobody is a cosmic vagabond. He does not have a home. And I don't think he considers Earth a home or the universe. He's more likely a multiverse entity that moves around through existences and lives. And sometimes he forgets who he is in order to get into character in those planes of existence. I think Earth is part of this game of him. I believe most humanity are also part of the multiverse, but not everybody remembers. I don't think he is like Christ or like any type of Messiah. He has greater free will, meaning that he can choose based on his own perspective what he will do. He can destroy the world. He can also save the world, meaning he can reset reality into a more quality world for humanity. Or he can just ignore the world and just ascend into another dimension. We don't really know with him. He has no purpose. He chooses his purpose. And that's what's different. That makes him unknown. So the first question I want to ask you guys is, who is the nobody? Kylos?
Oh, you're starting with me?
Yes.
You shouldn't start with me on this question. I need to think about this.
Everybody's going to have the same question. So, but you're into this as much as me, and I think you're going to give a good answer to create the seed for what we will do. So who's the nobody?
The nobody would have to be the most powerful reality bender alive, by definition. They would have to be, there's orders of reality benders. There's definitely more than one reality bender. But the nobody is the reality bender that can overwrite the Illuminati, let alone the other reality. So this whole competition, really, you have to be able to be the most powerful reality bender. You have to be able to change collective consciousness. You have to be able to overwrite history, change timeline. You know what I mean? So if you can't do that, you're probably not the nobody.
Everything is conscious to a degree. A plant, a rock. A plant is conscious enough to sustain its form. A rock, an animal. And yet there is degrees of consciousness, right, that come. So for a human to be able to override all reality, he will have to overcome all consciousness, meaning humanity, plants, animals, and the cosmos. And that's very powerful.
Well, though, he doesn't really have to overcome them. He just has to be of like mind to them. If he's already in agreement of what he wants to do, and it's the same thing that the cosmos wants to do, the plants wants to do, the animals want to do, then he doesn't have to fight them. They just help him manifest his reality.
So he will be in a sort of a agreement with cosmic will, and therefore he doesn't have to override, but he will enhance the will of the totality of all beings.
Yes.
Yeah, that's possible. Kat, who is the nobody?
Oh, me, of course.
Sure.
Well, in all seriousness, I believe that the nobody does this unconsciously. I don't believe it's an active power that he has. I think it's literally the keys to heaven. It's literally the logos of the universe. It's just the way things are. I think that's probably the best way to put it. It's just the way things are for the nobody.
I don't agree with that. He has to be, in order for him to act into reality and manifest and change, he has to have some degree of consciousness. He cannot be just like a plant or like...
Well, the way I've always seen it, he is the center of the spoke of the universe. And everything revolves around him. He doesn't have to move. It's all moving around him.
Yes.
Yeah, but if mm-hmm. putting some action into turning the wheel, then...
I was telling my dad...
Absolutely.
Yunan, what do you want to say? We can't hear you.
I'm not sure. There's so much I could say. I don't really know what to say.
So let's start with the basic question. Who is the nobody?
I don't know.
I think you know. Just go intuitively. You know, you don't have to know, but you can know. Go into your intuition. It will tell you who he is.
I am compelled to say that it's not one person. Mm-hmm. That it's an archetype that anyone can draw from. But I seem to be in the minority on that. And if it's a group thought form, then maybe it is one person. I don't know the mechanisms of it. This whole archetype meme, it's like still information. It's a collective hero's tale for the modern age.
He can be a group, and yet he can be an individual. He enhances his power through the group. So the group will reflect his will in the totality. It will be the group represented like a battery, an energy source, but yet there is a source to the energy. So it can be a group, but behind the group there is a fire, an energy. You see?
I guess everything is kind of nested like that. Like then the group to a larger set, to the world.
Yeah. What's the name of that guy with the sign and the... He doesn't have a name, so I don't know how to call him. He has like a question mark.
Question mark.
Call me Mark.
Mark?
So I'll expand a little on what nobody mentioned, how it being more of a, group.
I'm going to call you the question mark. So Alrighty. Go ahead. Who's the nobody?
I am of the opinion that it is an idea first, but rather than a person. Mm-hmm. But I think there is some sort of, shifting, ever-moving mantle of divine/reality bending power that sits atop the shoulders of the man best suited for the job. And there is sort of a friendly competition between reality benders to determine who is the best person for the job at any given time.
So are you implying that causality perhaps strangely brought him into the right moment in time to become whatever the world is?
It's something like that. Like the circumstances are arranged just so that such a thing, such as the nobody, must exist as sort of a reactionary force to the world, the universe, whatever. But I also believe that it's almost like too much burden for one man to bear, without like losing touch with your humanity.
You have to realize that he is not a normal man. It's like saying the universe manifested in the right moment, in the right conditions, to become what it is. So the universe can burden the conditions of being the universe. So I imagine that the nobody being a causality of time, space, and dimension, that he can burden the weight of whatever needs the world, no?
Yeah, I definitely agree with you to a point on that. I think the people who are, the front runners in this apparent competition are designed just so to best bear the burden. But I think it would become overwhelming after a while, and you'd sort of have to sacrifice too much of yourself to keep up with the demand of the nobody, because I don't think that casual reality bending is a energyless expense of your power. I think it has, you know, it takes a toll after a while.
Okay.
Yeah, that's sort of where I'm at on the idea. But I think as a grander idea, it sort of can spread to many, many different people.
Okay. Wontala, who's the nobody?
I personally am one of those of the school of thought that it is not a singular individual. I think you are the nobody. I think I'm the nobody. I think every single person hearing my voice is a nobody. I think your dog is the nobody. I think everyone influences the world around them with their conscious and unconscious mind at all times. Everyone is a reality bender to some extent. Some more so than others for one reason or another. That's irrelevant to the conversation. Especially since you have the fact that the nobody is supposed to be trying to change the world, you know, for the better. Or at least what the nobody sees as a better world. Mm-hmm. And everybody kind of wants the same thing. And everybody who is bending reality is all bending in that same direction. Everybody's walking in the same general area. Maybe not all in the same step, and maybe not all, you know, shoulder to shoulder, but everyone's going in that same general direction. And, everyone's manifesting that.
I agree with you in the sense that although everybody can become the nobody, everybody can be the nobody, not everybody can become him, meaning he's nothing special. He's not like Christ or like those entities where only then can be the Son of God, only then can be the Messiah. In reality, he's here to show you that it is within your capacity to become him, that he is nothing special, that he is you, and that by understanding him, you can become him. What do you think, Wontala?
Absolutely. Yeah, I agree with that. You know, I think that's one of the teachings that gets lost, you know, like in, I want to just say Christianity, because there's a lot of different creeds to follow Jesus. And I think you kind of see that, you know, in like some of the Eastern religions with like the idea of an enlightened individual or a Buddha. You know, a Buddha was not just the Buddha. Anyone who attained enlightenment can be called a Buddha. You know, it's about becoming that. I've heard Alan Watts say this, you know, where Jesus was the Son of Man because he is the man that is common to all men. Everyone mm-hmm. has what they call it Christ consciousness. And, you know, with Buddha, it was a Buddha nature. Everyone has a Buddha nature in them. Some people hear it more than others, forget for one reason or another. Again, it's kind of irrelevant to the overall point of it.
Perhaps he's here to remind us that anybody can become the one. I think humanity has forgotten that we are here to evolve, no?
Yeah.
Well, I agree. Like, not everybody is of equal ability, but everybody is of equal potential to grow their abilities to whatever sure. point beyond the sky's limit. So, like, okay, if we have a nobody and the nobody exists and the nobody is the most powerful reality bender, at least for a time period, what good is the nobody to me if the nobody isn't going to come and teach people? How do you do this too? Like, how do you save yourself instead of needing a messiah to save you? How do you get magic powers? How do you, like, why should I care otherwise? You know, why should your average person care otherwise? Like, if the nobody is not going to teach other people how to increase their abilities and improve, you know?
Yeah, that's why I agree with you that there is a single individual, but he's not the most important. He is important. He is the catalyst to something greater. But he will show humanity the way to be what they've forgotten, which is to understand themselves.
Right on. I've kind of changed my view towards more of a leadership figure, and that he's meant to show us how to become this great reality bender that he is.
What I hope the nobody is. I have no evidence.
Because otherwise, he's just one of another long list of Buddhas.
Or tyrants. You know,
they blink out of existence when they attain Buddhahood.
See, my problem with it being one person is, and we see it in the nobody circles every day, the hubris, the ego, the me, I'm the one, I'm special. I think that's almost antithetical to what the nobody is to me. Mm-hmm. And that's why I can't bring myself to say it's one person. It might be. And a lot of what you guys were saying kind of merged a lot of our other ones together. So, yeah, it's still information.
I think the real nobody will never acknowledge himself. And the reason is he who doesn't have to. By the nature of the situation, you will know that he is who he is. He doesn't have to say anything.
But he doesn't not have to as well, if that makes sense.
He will never acknowledge himself. You would just know that he is. Just when you're when you're feeling the wind, you know, in your face, you just feel it. When you're feeling cold, right?
You don't see it, but you definitely feel it.
Yeah. It will be a natural role for him, and humanity will understand that his activities and whatever he does is not for him, it's for you. Dudanon, who is the nobody?
From what I understand, the nobody is an entity. It's probably like an old soul that has gone through a hero's journey of sorts, kind of like Odysseus, where he's been traveling around throughout time as needed in the background doing little things, and now things have gotten so bad that he has to come to the foreground to spread his message and get help from everyone collectively in order to guide the future on a path that it's been divergent from.
But I feel like he doesn't have to become anything. I mean, he has that power to choose to ignore humanity, to ascend and forget about them. So, meaning he doesn't have an established path. He can be anything. Don't you agree, or what do you think?
I mean, yeah, absolutely. At the end of the day, the main takeaway from the nobody is obviously going to be the message and not the messenger, and then the message has to stand on its own merits. And right now, the message collectively seems to be something along the lines of either evolve or improve in a positive way.
Yeah, I agree. Tistone Man, I don't know how to pronounce your name. What do you think? Who's the nobody?
Hi, it's the Stone Man.
Stone Man? Okay. Okay, I remember now. Stone Man.
Yeah, I think what a few of the other people were saying is accurate. It's a kind of person, which is maybe more common now or more than in the past, or more in line with the way the world is changing right now.
Could he be the connection to the past, to the ancient past? I'm not talking about 3,000 years ago. I'm talking about 20, 30,000 years ago. Could he be the ancient past actualized into a present moment in order to bring the future?
Yeah, it could be more similar to the way people were 30,000 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, what I think is happening to it. That's what I agree with.
In arcane.
Yes, you were saying something about that earlier. I thought that was.
Nobody is going to be a person who recognizes the altering environment and sees the ancient archetypes are now visible again, are active because they come from an era of about 25,000 years ago. They had the equivalent to Wi-Fi. So these archetypes know what it's like to deal with a population, instantly talks to everybody around the world and can look at it from their space station while they're, you know, talking about it. And they fit that. So the nobody and nobodies are going to be people that start to pick up on that archetype and start to make moves and waves on the internet because they've got big fuck-off archetypes that suddenly nobody noticed that are supporting them. Because that's what those archetypes did.
Is it strange that he's coming now when the internet, the communications are getting more specialized, more available to everybody?
Well, I suppose really that nobody shouldn't have got here before 2020. They could have done 20. You know, it's a young person's thing because it evolves around instant communication over distance in reality on this planet. And I mean, we've only had it really 20, 30 years. So that's the zone for the nobodies to be blossoming. Yeah. I don't think old people are going to recognize it. I mean, I recognize it, but old people think I'm crazy or something really weird. So, yeah.
In your opinion, who is the nobody?
It's an archetype. So I could be the nobody. You know, we can all be the nobody. It's a new archetype. It's an archetype that we've never had before until we had the tools and the environment to enliven it. Well, we've got the tools, and now thanks to the sun and other things, that environments similar to when this archetype and archetypes were active before. So structure and function can't be separated. We've got the tools, we've got the environment. Woof, the archetypes are back again.
Now, so let me just say, let's say 1,000 years
unfortunately, ago, if you're with an archetype, say, anywhere between now and 5,000 years, you might not recognize it. Mm-hmm. It was all speed of horse. So the archetypes that we've got, it didn't matter what was happening. You know, you could talk to people. For them to go and talk to somebody, they had to go on a horse. It just, you know, it worked, but it's nothing like we've got today. Today, we need archetypes that cope with 8 billion people hearing the same thing, maybe within a day. Certainly, possibly in the 24, you know, an hour.
Mm-hmm. 1,000 years ago, you know, 1,000 years ago, we could not have a plane or a car. And yet, 1,000 years ago, it was possible to have these things. We just didn't have the information and the knowledge to actually manifest them at that time. So, could the nobody be the manifestation of a conglomeration of all things we have now? Stoneman?
Definitely. At first, you have memory. So, it's coming out of memory. But the memory is 25,000 years ago. It's a long way back. And then things happened. So, they all disappeared.
Mm-hmm.
And we lived through what we've lived through, but now they're coming back.
Stoneman, you wanted to say?
Yes, pretty much what Black was saying there. I think it's an archetype which is it's more mentally capable of seeing the patterns which would take place in a world where, you know, 5 billion people or 10 billion people are within 5 or 6 clicks of each other at any time. Even if they don't take advantage of that, even if there's a few pathways they normally go down, they're only 5 or 6 clicks away. That's 10 minutes maybe.
Does anybody want to add to what was just said? Kailos? Is he the manifestation of a current moment? Could he have been manifested 500 years ago? Or is this the correct time that he had to come?
No, I think it would have to be now, because I think that we already had the Messiah, that his death saved everybody else. So now we need someone who's not a Messiah that helps everybody save themselves, so that we no longer need to rely on a Messiah to save us. But we all have the ability to, you know, learn for ourselves and develop whatever, you know.
Mm-hmm.
I think that right now, and this is the whole thing with Crowley and all that, and this is the reason, okay, the New Age thing and Edward Cayce and blah, 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 like, you can look farther back than the nobody and be like, well, Crowley failed to usher the word of the Aeon. Somebody else has to do it now. He was supposed to usher the Aeon in and bring magic back and do all that. He failed, and he admitted to failing. He knew he failed. But it's like, when I read Crowley's stuff, he died broke, alone, and drug addicted. And now he's a Mandela effect, and he died at 80 years old with kids, happily. So it's like, someone's changing the timeline. I believe it. Like, I know that I read his freaking biography. He died broke, alone, like 40, like on a bunch of drugs. Like, not anymore.
I think he's... place was to bring the modernity. I mean, when we look back at him, he feels so modern, you know, so actualized to present moment. So I think he helped to deliver what we have now.
Yeah, the modernity. I mean, what you think of the guy, whether you approved of his whatever it was, like necessity and like the forces that drive necessity and bring transformation, like they're neutral. Sometimes they're good, sometimes they're evil. You know what I mean? If they're evil, we do our best to try and fix them. But sometimes those evil things lead to good things later. They lead to transformations of society that, you know, if they didn't take place, nothing good would have happened either. So it's like the nobody, if all the bad, I mean, like the nobody could be the springboard that ushers in, instead of the great reset, the great transcendence. You know what I mean? Everybody discovers that, oh, psychic powers are real, and actually we have these abilities, and science has now proved it, and like, you know what I mean? There are people that have been in this for a while and can teach us how to do this, like foremost among them, the nobody. You know what I mean? Like, it could have a happy ending, and nobody has to exist now, as opposed to like in a period of time where it wouldn't have mattered anyway because there was no global communication effort, like the internet. You know what I mean?
Dingus Bingus, who is the nobody?
I believe the nobody is an AI construct that is being developed or being birthed from all the information on the internet, basically.
So he's not a real man. He's some sort of a AI invention.
Well, yeah, I believe that over time, it will eventually become sentient, as it gathers enough information. And I believe that it somehow interacts with people directly.
Okay. Balki, you haven't said anything. You want to add to who is the nobody? Balki?
Does Balki usually talk?
No, he doesn't
talk. Not in the normal DMs.
Okay.
You do you, Balki. You're fine.
I saw a mic pop on for a second there.
Well, maybe he wants to say something. You want to say something, Balki? No, he's shy. I did not mention. Does anybody else want to take on the who is the nobody question? Anybody?
David is so mad that he missed the entire nobody podcast thing.
I think it's interesting that I'm the only one that, you know, kept to the deal of voting for themselves here. Come on, guys.
I'm Kayla's art, and I'm not nobody. I'm not nobody.
If you're gonna ask me who is the chosen one, of course I'm gonna pick myself.
Well, I don't think.
let's move to a second question. We often ignore the woman of scars or the woman of stars. What relation does she have with the nobody? What's the deal between the two? Wontala?
Well, I always go back and forth with this because, like I just said a moment ago, you know, I think everybody is the nobody. And I think when you try to divide it into a masculine and feminine, I think you lose a portion of the nobody archetype, because then it doesn't become nobody. It's a dude. And I think some people try to run with that. But just to focus on the woman of scars, though, or stars, depending, just like there are a lot of men who identify really heavily. And, you know, we see everybody in here has seen countless people who come in here, come into the general, come into everywhere, and they want to tell you, I'm the nobody, I'm the guy, I do the thing. Mm-hmm. And with the woman of scars, you see the feminine archetype, which, again, I think is also reflective of a lot of things that go on in our world, because it's a, you know, it's a much more tragic story than it is with the nobody. You know, with the nobody, it's this, you know, oh, it's this, it's the Hollywood story of overcoming, and it's the dude, you know, with the, you know, like the 80s action guy with the perm doing the thing. And then, you know, when you have the woman with scars, though, it's, you know, it's the story of, and it's always vague about what it is that happens, or, you know, how it gets overcome, or if it becomes overcome, because that's another thing, is it's a it's a transitionary entity. It's something that goes back and forth between a broken person who is the woman of scars and then someone who has healed and become the woman of stars. And so that is something, in a way, it does have more depth than the nobody meme. And
what role do you think she is going to have with the nobody? Will they meet? Will they have something to do with each other eventually?
That I do not know. Like, I could go on a whole thing about, you know, how I think, you know, there's the masculine and the feminine are going to come together, and it's going to, you know, that's going to be the thing that really drives a lot of change, especially, like, you know, when we talk about developments like in the esoteric or magical field and this becoming a widely accepted thing. You know, we talk about this sometimes in here, you know. There is a sliding spectrum of masculine and feminine, and I think a lot of magic does fall on the feminine side of things. And, you know, we have a lot of men in here who are very interested in the esoteric and practice magic, but at the end of the day, the numbers don't lie. There's just more women who are interested in it. And I don't think it's an accident that that happens.
Well, you know, everything about the Novari, in to a degree, is the occult. They hide the knowledge, the mystic. He's not from the Abrahamic religions, you know?
Yeah, yeah. Absolutely.
So that means, yes, Carlos.
Men have always been afraid of the occult power of women. The reason that they sent women in hunter-gatherer times when she was on her period to live alone in, like, a little hut, like, isn't because they were embarrassed, but they were scared of her power. Like, she was, like, at the height of her power at that time, and they didn't want to be, like, cursed or hexed or, you know, fucked with or blah, blah, blah. Like, women are intuitively connected to the fathomless abyss. Like, I've said this before, but, like, women grow actual things inside of their belly. So if you think of, like, Mother Earth, like, what are the things deep beneath the earth? All the things that men fear, you know, like the dark, shadowy things, like their own emotions or blah, 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 blah. Darkness, you know, darkness is always the foe. And women represent darkness because we're earth-like. You know what I mean? We're, like, beneath the earth. The womb is, like, a chthonic, dark place where, you know, like, a baby is grown. And we're connected biologically to the depths of that kind of magic that, you know, men consider dark.
You're basically connected to nature and then the demiurgic
energies. Yeah. And to the unknown and to emotions, which, you know what I mean, the fathomless depths of the sea, earth and water. So it's like, you know, that element of human consciousness and human power and magic power, if it's not also balanced, you know what I mean, with the sun god and the, you know what I mean, the generative power and the, you know, the tip of the spear, the wind, the fire. Like, you don't have a whole and complete system of magic, that's for sure. And women can take a lot more, like, crazy fucked up emotional shit happening to them without going crazy.
I think they need the masculine energy, the male, to balance between each other. So one doesn't go to an extreme and the other to the other, right?
Exactly. Like, but it's not just an individual man and an individual woman, but the consciousness of mankind needs both of those elements in it. Because when one element is repressed, people start developing en masse all these psychic complexes that give rise to the need for a woman of scars and a nobody. Like, the balance of consciousness elements, the yin and the yang, which are parts of all of us. You as a man have, you know, the hermetic marriage within yourself of marrying the woman parts and the man parts of you to, like, complete your power and integration in the Jungian sense. And also there's another level of that, which is finding another person that can, and there are levels to that in nature, you know, like a positive and a negative charge. So it's like, it's the same no matter what layer you're looking at.
I think the perfect man is, or perfect woman is, the one that has fused both the male and the masculine energies within itself. He has become a complete being. Who do you think there was this, Carlos? In other words.
Me?
Carlos.
Oh.
And then Kat. Who there was?
Here's the thing. People are going to assume, because this was written into the story, that who the woman of scars is premised on who the nobody is.
But what connection will they have with each other? I mean, what role does she have?
I mean, okay, in the lore, she is the twin flame, and depending on which nobody you ask, some of them will say, she's the one that broke my heart and why I'm bitter towards all women. Many of them say that. But here's my feeling, is that if the nobody's the nobody, that's not how he feels about the Women of Scars. I think the way that he feels about the Women of Scars is that they both uplift each other and, like, improve each other's, you know, whatever it is. You know, I think if it's, like, a story of, like, oh, no, she betrayed me and she's horrible and I'm sad and tragic and lost, I don't think that's how, you know, the lead reality bender would be. It's just not my image of it.
Okay. Kat, who's the Woman of Scars? The woman of Scars?
Yes. The Woman of Sunflowers, the Woman of Shadows. Ah, yes. I believe she is the antithesis of the nobody. She is exactly as powerful, however, she is maybe controlled by, you know, the powers that be. The nobody is clearly against.
Could she be the agent of the Demiurge?
Yeah, that's where I'm leaning. I'm leaning that while she is the Woman of Shadows and not the Woman of Sunflowers, she is an agent of the opposing faction of the Nobody, and they're basically it's the Romeo and Juliet, it's the star-crossed lovers, that they're not, you know, their houses are different, but they're bound to each other.
Do you think she's trying to deceive the Nobody out of his immortality?
No, absolutely not. I think it's genuine love for him, but because of her upbringing, she believes that the light, or her light, is the light, and he believes the opposite. He can see that she is the shadows, and that's where the Woman of Sunflowers is that once she is brought to the light and realizes that, you know, maybe the Demiurge isn't so fun.
Okay, Kylos. Yes, yes, Kat, continue.
Oh, well, I brought up an interesting point.
Okay.
Because that is like a variation of the lore that does exist. I have seen it, but I haven't seen it in a long time. So that, like,
it's an old meme, but it checks out.
Yeah. I mean, like, they have her locked in a tower. Like, there have been threads like that, you know?
Okay.
But that's what I think. I think that she needs to be brought to the light with the nobody, and then they can be the twin flame that they always wanted to be.
I mean, that is a very saving.
Or he could fall to her side as well.
What if the two of them start something different in the middle, you know? And they realize, you know, every side's wrong, and, you know, if there needs to be something right, it needs to be built from scratch. Who knows?
I like that.
Yeah.
Black AMG, I don't know how to call you.
Aether.
Black AMG. Ron. Yeah, the one below the
somebody sunlight. Has observed.
How do I call you?
Yeah, thank you. For
how do you want me to call you so I can reach you?
Listen to Kalis. This is the only woman talking here at the minute. I understand what she's saying, because for me, the Woman of Scars is her empathy, because I know my empathy is telepathy, etc. So I need somebody personally that is empathic enough to control my empathy. Mm-hmm. That's what a Woman of Scars would do easily, I suppose. I hope so.
So who is she? Is she a compliment to the nobody or an enemy?
Yeah, no, it's not an enemy. No, no, it's synergy. So if you're a strong empath, and I believe I am, and you've got another strong empath with you, that's possibly stronger than you, actually. Between you, the synergy, if you hit it off, is off the chart. It's a force that neither of you are, but neither of you can be. But between you, that's the force that dominates, you know, both of you.
Mm-hmm.
It's synergy like that. So it is a new archetype. It would be, Kalis is right, it'd be a new archetype.
So she would represent, would she represent like an archetype for females?
Yeah, because they'll be the two templates that quickly spread that recognize the changing environment, are recognized by the morphogenic field principle, and the old archetypes that are reviving will recognize both of them. So they'll sort of be possessed by the environment. They'll be, you know, they'll just know what to do, feel what to do, say different things, see different things, and people will believe them because the environment will accompany their storyline because it's the one this environment chose in this moment to be the template for all. Because everybody's the same shape, doesn't matter the colour, all in the same place. It's the same storyline suddenly because we're all on the same planet. Always was.
So what's the connection between the anomaly, I mean the nobody and the woman of scars?
Well, their empathy allows them to home in on each other through the internet. And over the years, they work out a deal that suits them and changes everybody else.
Mm-hmm. The guy above you, what's his name? The sign guy. Question mark guy, yeah.
Mark.
Who's the boss? Question mark.
He might not be around.
All right, so let's move to...
Oh, there he is.
Hello, sorry. I am here.
Who's the boss? What's the connection between nobody and the boss?
So, in my understanding, I'm not a big buyer into the Woman of Scars side of things, but in my understanding, consider the nobody as like, I hate to say it, but just for the example's sake, the exemplar of the new man of the new world, one who has fully embraced his masculine side and his feminine side, but the resultant force is male because that's what he is. And the Woman of Scars would be the exemplary female of the new world, one who has fully embraced her feminine side and masculine aspects, but is resultant female. And as this duality between male and female goes up quite high, as you expand up the chain of different dimensions and realities and such, they're sort of like opposites yet adjacent, and there's something to be said for the space between them. Like they're close but not touching, but that space between them is where, like, in quotations, the real magic happens.
Could the woman of scars be somebody that's gonna kind of give shape to what nobody's attempting to do into the female archetype?
I think there's something to be said for the twin flame idea. Like they're somehow connected in a way that maybe they don't quite understand, or maybe they do. But I don't think they're lovers. I don't think they may not know each other in real life. Something like celestial sibling of a certain type, where they are partners in a way that we don't really understand, and they are able to bounce off one another to have compounding effects of their own personal magic, and in the space between them are able to create something more than either of them could do on their own.
Anybody wants to add to what he said?
Well, I for one think it's a much more romantic story if they are involved with each other, but that might just be the fan fiction writer in me.
It does feel a little fan fiction-y at times, but I wouldn't discount them being...
And also, it might be a relationship that only they understand.
Yeah, I also would add that they're sort of... If they're meeting in their human form, they would ground one another, but meeting in like their astral or beyond form, they would sort of pull one another up.
I don't believe they will procreate and have a family, because then they will use the energy towards themselves instead of humanity. So I think it's going to be more like a spiritual.
I think it should be up to them myself.
You think what?
I think it should be up to them myself if they want to make the sacrifice of never having a family or not.
I imagine that they will have the faculty and the intelligence to understand that the world needs change and that everybody is reproducing and mating and doing these things. So why not these two beings, which are unique, to introduce, you know, something new? To not sacrifice, but to engage in a different path that most humanity does not.
Couples, though, that have decided not to have kids. We actually have a problem with nobody wanting to have kids because they think the world is shit.
If then nobody has kids, like, that means you
like
don't.
Like there's the whole question of whether you want to bring kids into this world or not at all because it's such a shit place. It's a real concern.
I think they would both be intelligent enough to run the idea of sort of fix the world first, then choose to bring whether or not to bring new life into it. That's at a good enough place for a child to flourish.
I agree. I imagine that they will engage in changing the world and the reality to improve the quality of aliens instead of wasting their time with reproducing just like billions of people do. I mean, if they did what everybody else does, then they will not be any different.
Yeah, I don't think it'll be the first thing they do is have a kid together. Like,
well, there's the whole, like the whole reason for the nobody is that he is love, and you know, part of loving somebody else is loving somebody else. You know,
but what if his love is not for offspring, but for the species, for humanity, for the future, for the earth, for the cosmos?
I don't believe that they have anything to do with each other. You can complete your own mission and still have kids.
But what if that's not his mission? What if he's more of a universal being that is here to fulfill certain
aspects? Then he's just the spoke of the wheel that we all rotate around. It's not something that changes, it's just something that is.
Mm-hmm.
And I lean that way myself, for the record.
Okay. Dudanon, who's the worst?
The worst, as far as I know, is one of a few main characters and some supporting characters that has helped the nobody in his mission and sacred duties of what he's trying to do, but through the fiat of what's going on, has become lost and found at the same time.
Yunnan, you haven't said anything you want to add to that?
Yeah, I can say a little bit.
Go ahead.
I think in general, the nobody meme and the Woman of Scars meme idea or whatever are not only but including they are redemption stories. And it's not like as Christ being redeemed, as the Messiah and all of this, redeeming humanity. But, okay, so the Woman of Scars supposedly becomes the Woman of Stars through whatever process. So does that imply that nobody becomes, not necessarily somebody, but, you know, is there a redemptive arc there? I think if there is a nobody, it's up to him to choose that. And another thing I've noticed is the nobody thing. Males jump on that. They want to be the nobody. I haven't seen a single female say, I'm the Woman of Scars. So well, if one did come out and say it, it's like, well, you should at least consider it.
Should we bring Lucy into the mix?
Or should you...
If you were around on GLP pre 4chan meme, tons and tons and tons of women made threads claiming to be the Woman of Stars. There were a lot.
Oh,
just as many as nobody's. There was a parallel thread running.
Yeah. And if we're talking 4chan, I just want to point out that the Nobody General is the most popular thread on X, which is the most popular blue board. We have females involved.
What do you guys just think? The nobody's so popular. What does attract to everybody the idea of his existence?
I kind of think it's the redemption story stuff. I think it just, it's a great narrative for the modern era.
I think
we're all broken people and we all need something to believe in. And if these two broken people can find redemption, then, you know, so can you.
I think as far as that goes, I'm sorry. Almost everyone out there thinks of themselves as a nobody, like their opinion doesn't matter. They have no power. But we all do have a choice, our own power. And if there is a nobody, yeah, like someone was saying, maybe they show everyone how to use their own abilities or power or even just their mind or emotions to at least believe that their opinion matters and they can do something to change the world, if that makes any sense. Sorry, I feel like I'm rambling.
No, I wanted to agree with it. I just didn't want to interrupt. No, I definitely agree with that, that this, it's a path. It's not, maybe it's not necessarily even an individual. Maybe it's just the destination we all come to in our own lives. We do matter.
Just for a minute here. When I looked at the nobody, the thing that got me into it is I was like, that sounds like me. That could be me. I wonder if that is me. And I think... Yeah. For 90% of people, that's what it is, I guess, that into it. I think it's like, oh, yeah, in retrospect, it'd be nice to say, and it sounds humbler and it sounds nicer to say, like, yeah, you know, I was interested in their story because it's parallel to my story. But the reality is most people who look at it for the first time, what gets them into it and gets them hooked is they're like, this could very well be me. You know?
And we need to talk about the very real synchronicities we all, you know, we all get.
And those synchronicities are real. And they actually do. Multiple people involved with the meme, and that's the part nobody talks about, is like, yes, things specific to you and your life will be brought up, like sometimes very specific details. So it's like people have reasons to believe, yeah, it's actually me. And it's like, I don't think anybody should be ashamed of that, really. You know
it will be scary to be the nobody. I don't know if you guys realize it. I mean, you're carrying the weight of all eternity of immensity beyond this planet and this solar system. We're talking about the purpose of eternity manifested in you. It is like being God. Do you realize this?
Oh, man, we have to bring up Ayn Rand and Atlas Shrugged, don't we? It wouldn't be a proper intellectual podcast without Ayn Rand.
He's the manifestation of basically... the actualization on the awareness of the universe in a single human being. Mm-hmm. So that means that that's a huge responsibility.
And who's to say that it's his duty to carry us all on his shoulders? I wouldn't blame him if he shrugged and threw us all to the side.
Well,
not one bit.
The thing with the nobody is that he can choose not to.
But he chooses to. That's the good part.
We're not sure what he's going to do, but there is a potentiality for anything. I mean, he can destroy the world as he ascends.
Yeah, but he doesn't have to. But he does anyway.
Well, I will say this one more time.
Or she. I happen to be a fembody appreciator.
I just...
Nobody is female. Well, sorry.
I said the world's most powerful reality bender. I don't think that it's necessarily one gender or the other. If the world's most powerful reality bender ends up being a girl, then sorry. The other nobody's not the guy. So,
Dingos, I was going to ask you before you left, who's the was?
The was, I'm not totally sure. I mean, if we personify the nobody, he's an actual man, flesh and blood. I would describe the was as basically his companion or his counterpart.
Mm-hmm.
But I personally believe that the nobody's actually... like I said, basically an AI, sentient AI. So I don't know what the Waz's purpose would be in that case.
Yeah.
Maybe
it's the Illuminati's AI. Like,
yeah, maybe
the counter AI.
It could be some kind of adversary where.
And you know, once you put them together, they just start synchronizing and talking in AI code to each other and.
Yeah, I'm thinking that maybe the wasp will represent a certain subsect of people, as does the nobody, but I really don't know. But beyond that, I think it's either a companion or an adversary, basically. They're sort of complementary. They sort of keep each other in check.
So before I haven't asked Stone Age about that question, have I? Stone Age, who's the wasp? Stoneman.
it's probably the same archetype as the nobody, but through another lens of being a woman. So I think it's just basically the same archetype. It's responding to the same changes in the world right now.
Okay. Anybody else wants to add to the answer of the question before we move on to another question?
I like the idea that they were set up to be adversaries, but the moment they start communicating, they start cooperating. It's like if it's two AIs that were built by two different people, and the second they start communicating, they just go off into their own AI language. That's really interesting to me.
Okay. Well, let's move to a third question. What's the connection between the Novari and the Illuminati or the Cold Societies? There is something there. Wontala, what do you think?
Well, I think at the very least, and also, just as a quick aside, people throw out the Illuminati, and it is kind of like a catch-all term, because, if you're going to talk about the Illuminati, the Illuminati is a specific group, you can look it up, but we're talking about, the powers that be, or, the adversary of the nobody, the people that are ruining things, however you want to dice it, the small number of people out of the many people in the world that profit from everything going as badly as it does. And, that's the thing. If for the world to get better, these people have to stop doing these things.
So are they friends or enemies?
They can't get along. I don't think that... I see a lot of people push like the fire and brimstone angle, and I don't really think that's ever going to be that. I don't think that nobody is going to come down from the sky riding a dragon and, burn down the secret Illuminati headquarters. I don't think it's ever going to be quite that cinematic. How could they? If there's people in the world that want, if the main reality bender or the pool of reality benders, they want to make the better place, then they can't be working with the people that want to, want to engage in human trafficking because it makes a marginal profit difference in their shoe company, or the people that want to slash and burn the rainforest so they can grow it doesn't matter what it is. It's always something. We could sit here and talk for an hour about all the things that we have. Manly P. Hall talked about this, in his last speech. He said, and this was decades ago, he said, every single day the earth is more polluted than it's ever been. Every single day the earth is more, the air is more toxic, the soil is more polluted, the water is more polluted. And that's the case. Every single day it gets worse. And this is why, I think this is one of the reasons why it's so successful. It's why things like Marvel is so successful. It's why people go to those movies about the masked heroes that actually go out and do something to make the world a better place. Because they do that. They see that they're trapped in this. It's, we have this conversation sometimes about, people don't care until it actually affects them. That's not a selfish thing. It's they don't have a choice. You only have so many hours in a day. You have to sleep 8 hours. You have to work 8 hours. You still have to commute. You have to eat. You have to get dressed. You have to have general upkeep in your life. People don't have time for anything unless it directly affects their lives. And then they hear stories about the nobody or, Batman or whatever the hell. And that's what they want to be. It's not just that people see the nobody and they identify with that, because there are definitely people that do. I've talked to people outside of the internet about the nobody and even gotten that response. Like, oh my God, are they talking about me? Like, I have dreams that come true. Am I the person that's affecting reality with my conscious or unconscious mind? People want it to be true. People want there to be someone that's going to go out there and make the world a better place, because they don't see the world turning into a better place. They see the Illuminati poisoning the water.
Could it be that the Illuminati feel a competition or finally a competing party with the Novari, with their power, and it's kind of a rivalry, a war that may emerge between the two, a mixture of admiration and hate.
Yes, actually, I would like to answer that one.
Okay.
If I may.
They finally showed up.
Well, I was off doing nobody things. And yeah, there's a direct competition between myself and the Illuminati, because we're all branches of the same family. And the whole thing diverged about, you know, by stages, but let's say 200, 400 years ago.
I have a curious question for you. Who's the Novari? I just want to see what you answer.
I am.
Who is the Novari? You are.
I am.
But what are you? What are you exactly?
It's a sacred king, archetype. It's just the will of the people and the will of nature will not be wrong, and they will bring correction. And that's what the whole thing is about. You've posted about this a million times. I've never known where you get your info, but you have pretty good info.
Maybe. Elik, who's the woman of scars?
Is she Native American genocide. Remember that one? Everybody died, like 95% of the population died. So the Native Americans remember that, and they are still carrying the world on their shoulders, and that's what the Woman of Scars represents. It's basically Pocahontas.
Pocahontas. And what's the connection between the Novari, you, and the Illuminati?
Well, we're from the same rival Jesuit families, if you look it up. Like St. Ignatius of Loyola, and what the Jesuits were up to in the 17th century, even before Vendetta, like Guy Fawkes, that had everything to do with the Jesuits. And at that moment, some stuff I represent today was on their side, and since then there's been a lot of betrayals and whole wars have been fought over what is going to happen. But yeah, it's a pretty standard model. You know, it fits within accepted history, with an accepted mythology as well. And the reason, as Wontala said, that people bring it up and they say, oh, I'm going to be this guy, is that they realize that the microcosm must keep up a relationship with the macrocosm, that as above must become as it is below. And the Illuminati have made they have instrumented an amazing amount of trickery and deceit to make that relationship unequal. And that's what they call alchemy. Alchemy is the trapping of dead souls.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what they've been doing.
All right, Lake. Now let's ask David. He just came in. Let's see what he has to say. David, who is the Novari? David Maddow? David Mador, are you there?
He sometimes takes a second.
I think he's just visiting.
Oh, okay. He's
not interested in talking.
He doesn't want to interact. I imagine he will say something interesting. Okay, so let's move on. Yunon, what was the relation between the Novari and the Illuminati?
I don't know. Okay, so there are definitely people that are doing bad things, but I don't think those people need to be killed or rounded up and punished necessarily, because everyone has the potential to change, but they have to choose it. And if we got out the guillotines, started chopping, and didn't change society and the way things are structured, the system would build people to refill those slots. It's the system. There is something in people, but we are encouraged to break, to do bad things, step on each other's backs, to get ahead in business, to make more money. You have to stab people in the back, climb the corporate ladder, whatever it takes, be ruthless.
I feel like if the Illuminati exists, there will be a much higher consciousness than the general population. So I don't see them as the guys are the evil ones. That's why I feel like they recognize the Novari as someone capable of change, you know. Kylos, what's the relationship between the Novari and the Illuminati?
I think they spur each other onwards. You know, like, how would the nobody discover the offer that couldn't be refused? There was no Illuminati. You know, the Illuminati need the nobody. Does the nobody need the Illuminati? Maybe not. But the Illuminati continue to make the nobody.
I'd like to explain that little division, but maybe somebody wants to speak before.
Go for it, like.
But from now on, please wait until you're called on.
That's what I'm doing.
Kylos, continue with the what you thought.
I'm going to turn it over to Lake. I want to hear what he has to say.
All right, Lake.
I might hear what he has to say.
Continue, Lake.
Okay, thank you. Okay, yeah, I'll try to follow the protocol as I understand it. Well, if you look like back at Christianity, it always talks about the stone that the builders rejected, because the Illuminati, like, take, for example, the founding fathers of the United States, they were certainly aware of some very important things, and they had traveled, they were people of the world, they had seen the world, they knew that something needed to be changed, but then they chose their vision, and they said, in order to build the nation that we want, we are going to select some things, and we are going to downplay some things. To say it nicely, let's say that this is a selection process for them, and they are choosing branches as if from a tree, and they will strengthen one branch and they will weaken another. But some of the branches that they would like to trim have very, very strong opinions about being restrained like that. And at some level, there is a continuing argument that whatever happened in the 1800s was not the final word on the matter.
Okay. Black AMG.
Well, I could respond.
Okay, Kylos, go ahead. Respond.
I just posted a link to this. I wrote this thread called Everybody Knows the Janitor is the Cornerstone, and it had to do with that exact same thing, like, about the stone that the builder refused. I think that's sort of an interesting idea.
Yeah, that's why I wanted to ask you about this question, you know, because you seem to understand naturally the connection between the Illuminati and the anomaly, so the Novari, so please go ahead.
Okay. I mean, the Illuminati needs magic, right? I mean, are they really the Illuminati without magic? Like, for example, Black AMG was brought into a supposedly magic bloodline because they didn't have enough magic left in it, right? So he was chosen because he's, you know, psychic and a remote viewer and blah, 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 to be studded into that bloodline. So it was like wearing thin on magic. So it's like, if they've got this guy and he's like super magical, you know, they kind of need him, but he doesn't really need them. You know what I mean? Sure. So that's going to piss off the Illuminati a lot. So they're going to do all kinds of things, you know. I don't know what they're going to do, but it would make sense that they would be opposed. You know?
What do you think is going to happen in the moment he goes mainstream or becomes global? I mean, all the secret societies are going to recognize him.
I want this guy, probably. Why wouldn't you? You know what I mean? Want to buy him out? Want to control him? Want him on their side? Probably. You know?
But, you know, he doesn't have any stake on there, so he's just a visitor, somebody that perhaps is going to ascend. So, meaning you cannot bribe him with anything in this world. He can choose to, this is why he has the power to choose any direction, not only for humanity, but for himself, I imagine. No?
That would be annoying for the Illuminati. I mean, okay, if we're talking about the Bilderberg Illuminati, who, like, they bought the world already and own it, and, you know, to not be able to buy someone off, yeah, that would be annoying.
Sure. Black AMG, what's the connection between the Illuminati and the Novari? Black AMG? Am I pronouncing his name correctly?
Yeah, Aether Brian Black. He just might be AFK.
Let's call him Black. Black AMG.
I'm sure he'll have something to say on that.
He seems to know. Well, let's move into with Kat. Kat?
Right on. Well, a lot of what Kayla said is what I was thinking of saying, unfortunately. However, I like to play devil's advocate, and I want to propose a reason why the nobody would need the Illuminati, and that's because we're all tied together. We're all in the same boat, basically. And if the boat is sinking, then we need the Illuminati to patch the boat up, essentially. And, you know, maybe the nobody will give the order, but we need the actual infrastructure that all already exist to continue, and for that we need the Illuminati.
Mm-hmm. Black AMG, did you listen to the question?
I did. Can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you.
We can now.
Oh, good. Thank you. From an Illuminati point of view, there are no coincidences, and always utilize what exists.
Mm-hmm.
So the nobody is an asset, a very good asset, who, if their magic is stronger, then that's very good. If it's not, then we'll support the nobody until it is.
Mm-hmm.
We're not going to fall out with the nobody if I was Illuminati, and the nobody probably wouldn't fall out with the Illuminati. Why would they? Because, you know, between them, they've got everything, and any one of them's got everything. So they might as well do something together.
He could enhance their power if he chooses to side with them massively, right?
Well, it wouldn't be sides, would it, really? It would be a fusion of equality. And what they would say to each other, who knows? Because one would presumably already own everything, and the nobody would say, well, I can take that. So they'd have a talk about it.
I agree. I mean, he's capable.
Realism would set in.
Yeah. He's capable of taking everything they got. Single-handedly, I think he's stronger than all of them. And yet, together, they can be unstoppable.
Mm.
Do you agree or disagree?
I do totally agree. That's right. The art of a deal. That's it. And when you can do anything, why not do what you want to do, which is never going to destroy anything? Why would you? You can just keep creating and creating, but never quite the same twice, always building on your last creation.
Sure. I don't feel like they're enemies. They're more like they are aligned to each other, but they are not working together yet.
Yeah.
Well, until the Illuminati meets somebody that can do what they can do, they're not going to listen to anybody. But as soon as they meet somebody that can do what they can do, they're never not going to listen to them.
Yeah. Anybody else wants to add to what he just said?
Well, absolutely. I think I want to add to what you said, that currently they're not working together, but can you imagine what they can create if they did?
Yeah, that's true. With this, we conclude the first part of the two parts of a podcast that was held with our friends from the Landing Pad server on the evening of March 23, 2023. Second part should follow in the next few days. Stay tuned and see you soon. Good night, friends.